class. This is Management 301. I am Professor Kaufman, as stated on the board. Your syllabus is on Blackboard. I assume you guys were all little good kids and students and have already read the syllabus. So let's jump right into the lesson. So the lesson is Principles of Management. What is Principles of Management? What does it include? Well, it includes four functions of management. Four functions of management is planning, organizing, leading, and controlling. Where do you start? I like to start with leading, because when you start off in the workforce, you're going to be starting off as managers, maybe even some supervisors. But I don't assume that many of you are going to be CEOs right off the bat. It takes a little bit of work. So what you do with the leading when you're a first line manager is you take your employees and you conduct the business of the day. But how do you conduct the business of the day? You take what the CEOs and middle line managers tell you they're planning and organizing. You take that and you take it and you implement it into the workforce under you. So now I want to get what you guys think. Before I continue this lecture with some real world examples, I want to get your perspective on what you think great leadership is and what qualities a great leader should have or might have. So I'm going to volunteer you.
Well, I think leadership is like love.
Love is practically shunned from the business environment nowadays. People have this idea that it doesn't belong in the office, that it's all mushy and too confusing to measure. They think that by showing love to employees, you're essentially letting them off the hook. As a result, today's stereotypical office is a place of endless despair, where employees go to complete meaningless piles of work in the name of a bi-weekly paycheck. Now I know what you're all thinking. Love is for weak little sissies. But it's not. Integrating love in the office is just as challenging as in any other relationship. But managers who embrace love in the office are like awesome parents. They set up their team for success. If you think about it, if you love someone, you know that they will perform to the best of their abilities. And if they don't, you know it's time for you to step in and help them improve through encouragement. Therefore, love doesn't let employees off the hook. It actually pushes them to perform even better. And love can actually be measured in leadership. It isn't measured by how much the team loves the boss, however. The best way to see it is by how well your employees understand why their work is important and why they are an asset to the company. Employees shouldn't be scared to show their feelings while at work. Emotions lead to thoughts, thoughts lead to words, and words lead to action. A successful manager who practices love is able to minimize negative emotions and kindle positive ones. So don't be a hater. Take a moment to look at yourself and decide if you're going to be a manager who has the courage to stand up and show some love. Because love, it's not just an emotion. It can also be a weapon. A weapon that we use to crush our competitors. When I think of this, a special quote comes to mind. We are strong. No one can tell us we're wrong. Searching our hearts for so long, both of us knowing, love is a battlefield.
Interesting. I like the way you're thinking. How about you?
I think leadership is like Legos.
Although Legos are just toys, they're actually built on the foundation of creativity. Think about it. You're taking hundreds of individual blocks and putting them together into whatever your heart desires. What's even more amazing is that you can take those very same blocks and rearrange them into something totally different. And while this all sounds completely irrelevant, it is not. Ever since the crash of 2008, businesses have been struggling across all industries. We see some gradually declining, while others fall off a cliff into bankruptcy. In the midst of all this, you will see companies reorganizing their structure. Just like with Legos, leaders look at the pieces that come together into the current disaster. They take those pieces and find a way to rearrange them into something completely different. Great leaders can totally scramble what the company already has, like assets, employees, cash, and products, and try to rebound in the downtrodden economy. Some reorganizations completely fail, like a Lego creation that falls apart as soon as you pick it up. but others flourish and are the shining achievement of the creator, such as the skyscraper you were able to piece together. It's not about finding new pieces to add to what you already have. It's about looking at what you already have with a different perspective. Leaders understand this and continuously ask themselves, is this the best arrangement? How can I utilize the pieces I already have to make something better, more efficient, and more effective? Those who understand Legos understand innovation, which is what all great leaders must have.
Go. Thinking outside the box, I like. Go.
Well, personally, I think that leadership is kind of like riding a bike.
You can't pull out a pile of books and study your way into learning how to ride a bike. There are no college courses or certification exams to pass. The only way to learn how to ride is to grab a bike and get on. It really is an intimidating process, but it's the only way. At first, you may find yourself lost and overwhelmed by the mechanics of it all, but you can't let that get to you. You most definitely will wobble around with a shaky sense of balance and may even eat dirt. These failures will hurt you both egotistically and physically. You will be left feeling ashamed and covered in cuts and bruises. But as you punish yourself through the process, you will find that you gradually can go longer without falling, and the balance between ridings and wobbles will become less volatile. Your confidence shoots through the roof as you realize that you're starting to get the hang of it. Before you know it, riding becomes second nature. You stop and realize that you couldn't have made any progress without the inevitable failures along the way. Leadership works in the same way. A great leader doesn't become so by grabbing an MBA at the nearest university. He or she slowly rises to that level through the failures that he or she has experienced. Sure, sales will take hits and customers will be lost on the path you take. But in the end, you will emerge ready to lead the company to record profits. And the road doesn't end there. Great riders know that there will always be awesome new cutting-edge tricks to learn that add to their ability. The best leaders never officially graduate from their learning careers. They continue searching for the newest and most effective methods to add to their arsenal. So whether you want to be a rider or a leader, you can't achieve anything until you climb up and just start pedaling.
Actually, let me just voluntold you.
When I think of leaders, I think of gladiators.
Gladiators plan and organize themselves for battle 24/7. They don't have time to waste on leisure and recreation. Gladiators are obsessed with training and improving their skills in order to remain ruthlessly competitive with their rivals. And once they are at the top of their game, they keep looking for new battle methods to take advantage of, or else they become too predictable. Gladiators know that strength is measured in numbers. A lone man cannot accomplish what three or four can. Gladiators work as a team with other gladiators in order to survive in the cutthroat real world. They don't try to outshine each other. They all know that they need to rely on each other in order to become victorious. Gladiators are passionate about their clear vision and mission. They stop at nothing to rise to the top and best the talents of others in battle. When going to battle, gladiators don't simply dictate from the back. They lead the pack from the front. No one ever looks up to someone who hides behind the dangers of others. Gladiators are big risk takers. This is war, not treasury bonds. If gladiators didn't risk their lives in battle, they would be as good as dead with that title. Finally, gladiators are never overwhelmed. They keep a cool head and steady nerves, even in the most suicidal conditions. As a result, they almost always come out victorious. Gladiators are fearless winners, and so should leaders.
Wow, I never thought of leadership like that. You're going somewhere. I liked everybody's ideas on what they thought what leadership was and the characteristics it takes to be a leader. So now moving on, I have two real-life success stories on what leadership actually is And so this is my first example. So what is college for hunks? Omar and his partner had one truck and they would go from house to house picking up your junk. But he needed to expand, so he needed more trucks. What do you need when you have more trucks? You need more drivers. And he did not have the confidence or trust for other people to drive his trucks, because what happens when you have jobs that you don't like? You don't treat it with the care and that you would if it was your own property. So Omar had a solution to that. He made every employee feel like they were part of the company, like they owned a share of their company. So now each employee has their own share of their company. So now they're in charge of their marketing, in charge of their own maintenance for their truck, in charge with everything as if it was their own company. They even were given their own cards with their own little titles of whatever title they wanted. With this trust that he gave to his employees, he was able to expand his company from one truck to almost 300 trucks nationwide. So now he became a national brand. So this was a great example, right? So now let's move on to my next success story. So now for this next success story, we have Ryan. He's a college dropout, which I don't suggest for any of you, by the way. But he dropped out of college and he started his new business called iConnect. And with iConnect, he was really struggling. His first year, he was living in his office. He was taking showers at other people's houses. And to top it all off, his expenses were more than what he was bringing in from the company. So he was already in the hole $5,000. So from there, what could he have done? He could have just quit, but no, he kept at it. And with the persistence that he had, he moved on to hiring new people to raise money. They raised over $500,000 and invested back into Google Ads. And with the Google Ads, they were able to bring in more revenue, more customers. And now he's bringing in $26 million a year, and his projections are to be at $50 million within the next couple years. So now, with those success stories, you can now apply your examples and see how that ties into these success stories and how they use leadership to succeed with their business. So in Solomon's story, he showed love by giving trust to his employees so that they can manage their own part of the business. Comparing these stories with riding a bike, you know, they're riding the bike, but yet if they fall, they don't just stay off the bike. They get back on the bike and try it again, maybe in a different way, until they have that success of riding the bike without falling. Now in both of these stories, they had the structure of their companies, but unfortunately that structure wasn't working. So like Legos, they disassembled and rearranged and made it into something better. So these two businesses in the beginning were essentially failing. Instead of losing their cool and panicking, they kept their cool like gladiators, even in the heat of battle, so that they can succeed. I hope you learned something, took notes. Next class, we're gonna go over planning.